each aspect of epigenetics. First is DNA methylation. So you can see here, this is the nucleosome, but let's start from the very first step, DNA methylation. So DNA methylation, depending on the organism, in animals, it's mostly on C's, just on the nucleotide C. And there is a reaction that happens. So you can see here is the regular cytosine on the ACGT sequence, right? On the C, if this region is changed, originally this region is a H hydrogen, and now it's, you know, there's an enzyme called the DNMT. It's an enzyme that will add a methyl group from the replace the original H with a methyl group here. Then you get a methylated C. Okay? These are actually later discoveries that only happened, I think, in the last 7-8 years. People previously didn't know how DNA were demethylated. They know this is kind of happening in a cell, but initially it was considered that once a region is methylated, in order to demethylate, you have to cut it out and replace it with an unmethylated C. But in the last a few years, it was discovered there is actually a reaction step by step that DNA methylation can be demethylated back into a regular cytosine. These are in a lot lower abundance than either of these forms. Most of the DNA in the cell are either in the unmethylated form or the methylated form. These are like 1%, 2%, tiny percentage in the genome. And so most of the cells are in this situation. In bacteria, there are also DNA methylation that happen on different nucleotides. And so the reason bacteria has DNA methylation is sometimes when the bacteria is infected by a virus, so the bacteria has different enzymes that will cut DNA. But if a region is, so it cuts DNA like a transcription factor recognizing motifs. You recognize a nucleus like a six-mer sequence. But if the, on that DNA is methylated in a specific way, the restriction enzyme, the enzyme will know, okay, that's my cell, I don't want to cut it. But when a virus or some other species or DNA will go in, it will say, that region is not methylated. Then it will go and cut it out. So it's a way for bacteria to eliminate viral infection. With animals, most of these are not really for, well, it's actually also for dealing with viral infection, but it's a kind of a different mechanism. I'll talk about that a little later. But in a lot of genes, actually methylation is important to regulate gene expression. In the genome, actually, we should just go to this. Okay, so in the genome, once it's methylated, during the unmethylation process, there is sometimes unmethylated C during DNA replication can very often be recognized as a T. And so sometimes when DNA replication happens, a mistake will happen, and that C will be converted into a T. As a result, if this region is not so important and is not methylated, over time in the evolution, it will be converted to a T. And that's the reason in the genome, actually, we have more ATs in the genome than CGs, at least in human genome. The regions that will maintain a C is because that region, that C, is very, very important. And very often, DNA methylation in that location is very important. And those, the sequence will maintain, like keep the C sequence. In addition, in human, most of the DNA methylation happens on a C right next to a G, or a CpG methylation. So we call it a CpG. So there is a phosphate group between the two nucleotides. It just means a C followed by a G. And so for DNA, you can see here, because it's double-stranded, when you have a CG, the reverse strand also has a CG. Okay? And this process of isolation, usually in the cell condition, is pretty is symmetric, which means if one strand is methylated, the other strand is also methylated. And so when you make a new DNA replication, you make a new copy, each of these will be a template. The newly synthesized DNA initially was not methylated, but then the DNMT enzyme will go in and realize this is called a hemimethylated. One strand is methylated, the other strand is unmethylated. You will know to make the unmethylated also methylated. And so during DNA methylation, DNA replication or cell division, this DNA methylation gets inherited, and that helps also to maintain the cell identity. Okay? So in the genome, we have CpGs. You can see all of the CpGs only accounts for 1% of the total DNA bases, a C followed by a G. It's a small percentage. But in some regions, there are connect like a string. You look at this 200 base pair region, suddenly you see a lot of C followed by a G. And this is called a CpG island. And very often, a CpG island happens fairly close to the beginning of a gene. And so you could just see like this. This is the beginning of a gene. CpG island very often happens 1 kb from the transcription star site. You would see a region that has pretty high concentration of C followed by a G, like many, many copies of this. And so this actually is where DNA methylation has a very strong effect. Okay? Yeah, so these are the CG rich regions that have a very high density of CG. And depends on whether they are methylated or not, it really has a very strong effect on how this gene is regulated. So it turns out that in front of a gene, if the promoter CpG island is methylated, this gene will unlikely to be expressed. It's a way to silence the region. But if this region is unmethylated, that gene has a potential to be activated. You know, whether it really activates depends on other things, transcription factor, polymerase, but at least not having the DNA methylation there will give the gene some potential to be activated. Okay? And so that's actually important. Yeah, so 60% to 80% of all the CpG in the genome are methylated, but if you look at the promoters, 70% of the genes have CpG island in front of the gene, and depending on the cell, that CpG can be activated, or the region or the island can be methylated or unmethylated, and that will have an effect on the downstream gene expression. Oh yeah, so here is the replication. So initially, we have two copies. This is actually, yeah, so this is actually two chromosomes, I think, not two strands. So there are two different enzymes that are related to DNA methylation. The initial one is called de novo methylation. So de novo methylation is when DNA is replicated. I have to check this one. I think these are. Yeah, this is actually the two strands of DNA, not the two chromosomes. It is the two strands. Initially, it should be, in this case, methylated. Yeah, so the de novo methylation is from unmethylated to a methylated stage. When we were embryonic stem cell to differentiation upon a certain day, actually all the DNA methylation is erased, and DNA methylation reestablished. And that at that time, there were some enzymes that are used. It's a DNA, like de novo methylation, from nothing to methylated. But once you have this, the cell now has an identity, you know it's this kind of a blood lineage or brain lineage. Initially it was probably like this, but then when DNA replication happens, you see here, this is the parental copy, this is the new strand of DNA. There are enzymes called make sure that originally the two copies, not the two copies, the two strands, when they are different, it creates for as the other methylation. There it is.
So if these are just enzymes, can they be introduced into like cells to induce like methylation?
It's hard to reintroduce an enzyme, but it's sometimes people introduce an inhibitor of this enzyme to prevent DNA methylation. That actually is now being tested in a clinic for cancer, cancer treatment. So this part, you know, happens in the very early like embryo development, but this happens whenever our adult cells are still dividing. Then we just need to maintain this. Okay, and so in order to really see, so this is the same thing, the DNA methylation in here, and then this is added to the other strand. Yeah, and so in order to really see this happening, there are two different approaches to look at the DNA methylation. We mentioned, remember, there are restriction enzymes that will cut the DNA if the DNA is not methylated. And so you can imagine, if you have somebody's DNA, you cut with the restriction, in the early days it's like this, you cut the chromatin with this enzyme, and you run different individuals, or you run the cut out like gel in different individuals or different organs, and you compare, you can see actually they go, you know, they have different patterns that tell you something is different. But nowadays, the better approach is bisulfite sequencing. So bisulfite sequencing is like this. Bisulfite is a reagent. You treat the DNA, and all the C's that are methylated will be still a C, but anything that is unmethylated will be converted to a T. And then you do sequencing, just like you sequence the whole genome of some individual. You have to really cover every region multiple times. Okay? This really gives you a very, very high resolution result. Also very quantitative result, but it's quite expensive. I'll show you how this is done. For example, this is the reference genome. Okay, we sequence some guy. Let's assume in this location we have, you know, all the reads. But in reality, the reads are not all the exact same reads. It will be kind of staggered because we just shear the chromatin into many, many pieces. And so if we look at this coverage, you say, okay, in here, this is the top is the reference genome, and here, normally you have like 30x coverage, but let's just say we have 5 copies of this region. And so every time we see a C, we go, the original DNA is it methylated or unmethylated? It's methylated. That's why you see the C. But then when you see a T in here, we know the reference genome is a C, and now we see a T. That means it's being converted into a T by bisulfite. And so we know in this region we have 60% methylation. Okay? Whereas in this region, like all 5 nucleotides are converted, and so we know it has 0 methylation. Okay? So that's kind of a way to look at methylation. I mentioned in this case, once you have bisulfite sequencing, you know where it is coming from. You can calculate the methylation level, right? Each cell in that location, what is the percentage of DNA methylation? However, when you have these kind of bisulfite sequencing data, can you think about what do you need to do when you have this bisulfite sequencing? It's like a whole genome, like you treat the DNA or the chromatin with bisulfite, you do your conversion, you shear the DNA into small pieces, you go sequence, you get a huge FASTQ file. What do you do first?
You have to do quality control and make sure that they
You do FASTQC, right? What's the next part? You map it to the genome? How do you map it back to the genome? This is the tricky part, right? Because if the region is methylated, that's the original genome. You can still map it. But if this region is being converted into a T, you map it back to the genome. It's different, right? You can't find the location. especially if you are in the CPG island region, there are many, many CGs in here. It could be that the first C is methylated, the second C is not, the third is methylated, the fourth is not. I mean, there is a chance, right? So how do you deal with this? It's kind of tricky. Yeah, so for example, when you see a bisulfide read and also a reference as C, you know this is okay. But when you see a bisulfide read as T, and the reference is T is okay, but when you see a bisulfide read as T, it might actually mean the reference is C, which adds complication. If your read length is long and there are many C's or T's on this sequence, every T can potentially have come from either a T or a T, right? Therefore, one way is, you know, you have your original reference genome, but then every time you see a bisulfide read, if there is a T, you say, okay, I need to map this pretending this is a T or this is a C, and try to find that location in the genome, right? And so next time I see a T, I also say, what if this is originally a C and converted into a T, right? So every time you see a bisulfide read that is a T, you have to try to convert it into a C and see whether you can find a good location into the genome. So the search space or the read mapping for bisulfide mapping is a lot slower and takes longer time. Okay, Melissa.
So the bisulfide sequencing basically changes all unmethylated C's into T's, not just the C's before G's?
I think so. I think so. All the unmethylated C's into a T. In fact, when you look at this situation, this is just a scenario. When you do the analysis, you can find out where the methylation of C happens. And actually, that's one of the very early studies. When they did the bisulfide sequencing, they realized actually in adult cells, most of the DNA methylation happens on CG. But when you look at the embryonic stem cell, they also found that DNA methylation can happen on CAG or, CTG. So it probably more happen on CAG. In adult cell, this almost never happens. But when you do bisulfide sequencing, they found actually in stem cells, this DNA methylation can happen in other patterns as well. Okay? But then I forgot to mention one thing that is complicated. Oh yeah, so there are some algorithms like a Bismarck. You can create additional, so there are two ways. One way is you change your read, your sequence the read, and then convert the original T into a C and map to the standard reference genome. So map it to the reference genome. Another possibility is you use your original sequence, but you convert your reference genome into a T, all the C's to a T. So create additional sequence in the BWA reference genome for the index. And so every time in the reference genome that has a C, you can also make an index to convert it to a T. Right? Either way is okay. And so you can look at the mapping. One potential complication is we are checking the reference genome, but sometimes our reference genome are different. Like if you just sequence the regular DNA, our DNA might be different. How do we know that we are sequencing, it's because that guy indeed has a T, you know, not the reference genome, which is a C, or maybe it's a sequencing mistake. That also can happen in a small percentages. Or maybe this guy has like two copies. One copy is a C, the other copy is a T, right? How do you really get a reliable readout? For example, you have these two reads in here. How do we know I'm reading it correctly? Like, is it really correctly TG in the reference genome? Or not, in this person's own genome, or is really a CG that being converted into a TG? Eugene?
You just sequence twice, once without bisulfate.
Yeah, that's really expensive, right? How can you do this informatically, Peter?
Can you look at the complementary strand and see if it's matching?
Perfect. So when you sequence, you can sequence from, it's automatically sequencing both strands. You know, when you sequence a genome 30x, roughly half of them are on the top and half of them are on the bottom. And so, let's see. If you look at the reverse strand, so this is the, if the top strand is actually a TG, the reverse strand, you should see, so the reverse strand, you should see, yes, from here. If this one is a G, the reverse strand should be a C, right? And if that C is unmethylated, it will be a T. And then this is a T, and this is a not the same fragment. Okay? I guess you can use the same fragment as well. You know, when you do paradigm sequencing, it could be the forward and backward, they help each other. Steve?
So it seems like, is it always a good idea to do bisulfite sequencing all the time, just so you get more information?
So bisulfite sequencing, you do get more information. It's a quantitative, you know, also it's a high resolution. You know exactly which nucleotide is methylated or not. The difficulty is it is pretty expensive. So there are methods developed actually initially by Alex Meister here at Harvard, except that now he's in Germany. They do reduce the representation by bisulfite sequencing. They say it's too expensive to do genome-wide. They have a procedure to narrow down on just the CpG-rich regions, which you know is like 1% of genome, but then you get your sequencing effort done. That's also doable. But the downstream analysis is still similar. Okay? So maybe we can start.